case you want to know, I'm Joe Nasty. I ain't nobody, but
But his family loves him.
Born and raised in Chicago. Mm-hmm. I've never been in jail, thank God. But I have been in war. And that's what this is about, to let you know what I'm doing, mm-hmm. what I've done in the past.
Mm-hmm. I would like a story, a bazooka story.
Oh. Okay, we had this little battle that we're going into, and so the machine gun there was stopping everything. We had to get past that machine gun. We had to wait for the tanks, but before the tanks got there, so Joe, get that bazooka going there, and all kinds of crap was going on. And I was somewhere else. And they were hollering for me. I said, they calling for me? Yeah. Man, all kinds of small arms fire going on, and massive confusion. So I started running across all this stuff, and I wasn't even getting hit. I didn't realize what I was doing. I was just running across all that small arms firing. And these guys all, they couldn't believe that I was just a Sunday run, you know?
Sunday stroll, right?
A Sunday stroll through all that firing and all that small arms fire. So all that mess and confusion. So tanks hadn't arrived yet, and so finally I had to see if I couldn't get that machine gun out of there. So I got over there, and you had to have two guys on a bazooka. Had to have one guy put the shell in. Mm-hmm. Then you got a wire, you got to hook it up, and it's ready to go. Well, I got as close as I could, but man, they were trying to get me. And so I finally got there, and I wasn't going to get any closer because they knew I was there. And I fired that thing, shot, and went over the heads. And it hit something else close by. It stopped the firing for a while. They said, man, they probably figured, you know, the guy had that was a bum shot. So put another bazooka shell in there, and I was ready to go again. But this time I brought my main down, and they were trying to hit me again. And I'm going down. Like a snake. I don't want to expose myself. So fine, I got up a little bit, got that bazooka going, and I forgot who was with me. He said, Joyce, are you ready? I said, yeah. I said, remember, you hit me in the back when you're ready. So he hit me in the back, I knew he was ready, and I let go. That time I got it. I got the doggone machine gun. Mm-hmm. Well, I got the main one out of the way. The tanks came up, and they fired all the way down the line, and then they called for a charge. We had a couple of cabins or attached huts in that area, and the Japs are underneath and on the sides in there. So what happened? They want us to charge alongside the tanks. So we did. You should make a lot of noise, they told us. So we started screaming like a bunch of Indians. Yeah, yeah, whole dunk online. We screamed. The Japs were stunned. They didn't know what the hell was going on. We're using their tactics. And we're hung like, woo-hoo, 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 like a bunch of Indians. And we attacked that position. And then the tanks let loose. The tanks almost tore the doggone the cabins, whatever they were, almost tore them down. And then they stopped firing because we got in their way. They stopped firing, and then we took care of the rest. We took care of the some guys had a hand-to-hand fighting. Mm-hmm. I didn't. I got in there, and I just fired away. Well, I just, well, I must have fired about 2 or 3 doggone clips of ammo. One after another, bam, 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 at these guys, at those nips. And then I'd hit the ground. We'd all do that, you know. We jump up again. I don't want to give them a good target.
Right.
And, well, we took that position. We took it. Mm. And another time, that battle where I said we picked up that kid with the blood.
Munoz.
Munoz, yeah.
Munoz.
Well, we were out there on the side, another battle there, towards Munoz, and or it was another battle there, I forget which one of them. One of them was, we were attacking this position, and this is where that kid I was telling you about, where we picked him up off the ground. He died on us.
Oh, yeah, yes.
That battle there. Mm-hmm. That wasn't Munoz, that was another place.
That was Cabochon.
Huh?
Wasn't that Cabochon? Or
Cabatuan?
Cabochon.
Well, somewhere in there. Anyways, we went in there. And I don't know, I can't remember who it was. What was I at before that?
We were talking about with Shorty and F&E Company, the Cabochon Hills.
Well, anyways, this battle I'm talking about was a real rough one. This is where the Japs, we attacked it. They threw us back.
Mm-hmm.
We hit a rock. We hit a rock wall. I mean, we couldn't go any further. And the thing is, we just held our ground, and we let the dang on artillery chew up that ridge for us. And artillery was dropping their dang on shells on it like crazy. And we tried it again to get up there.
Mm-hmm.
They threw us back. I mean, they really, really hit us hard. So finally, we just dug in and stopped right there and trying to figure out a way to get them. And finally, what we done, we called it an airstrike with the napalm bombs. So finally, about an hour later, here comes about 3 or 4 bombers, B-24s, come in there, and they put that whole damn ridge on fire. And Shorty Forthar, my buddy, we were close enough, but he was a little closer, and the stuff bounced off the dung-on trees or whatever. It hit his arm and was burning his uniform and his hand, burnt his hand too. You know, but anyways, that fire did the job, finally.
Mm.
And we charged that ridge again, and still there was some doggone Japs alive in there, you know. We got them, but we said, what the hell? So, you know, the thing is, we backed up again, waiting for a counterattack that never came, because that attack that we did, I mean, we really give it to them with that airstrike and with that artillery and with our charges in there and everything. We finally did it. We broke up that mother load.
Mm-hmm.
That was, they really had that ridge fortified,
mm-hmm.
but real good. And like I'm saying, they stopped us twice
mm-hmm.
from going in there. We took a hell of a beating 2 times, and the third time we were all mad. They said, they're going to do it again.
Mm-hmm.
And we took it. We finally took the bridge. And there's a lot of Japs who were wounded. But we killed them right there on the spot. We wasn't going to take any prisoners. They never did anyways.
Mm-hmm.
But we never took them. And I forgot the name of that battle there. I think it was just outside of, maybe it was just outside of the Cabochon Hills.
Mm-hmm.
Cabaroon.
Yeah.
Yeah, but...
So, tell me what you were doing when you found out that the Japanese surrendered. Where were you?
Surrender. I was in...
What battle were you in? Where were you? In Manila? Luzon?
I was on Luzon mm-hmm. that time. And I was in the mountains. And I can look in that area where they dropped the atom bomb. Mm-hmm. I can look the whole damn sky for miles and miles around. It had an eerie looking red. I mean, I never saw a red color like that before. And it was for miles, and we were all worried that the fallout might come and hit us with fallout. Mm-hmm. And all the guys were worried about that, even though it was over beyond us. But the clouds all got red, real red, all around us. Mm-hmm. You know, and we was all worried about that damn thing. You couldn't blame us because that stuff was pretty bad stuff. And no, nothing happened.
So they didn't take you home. Where did they take you guys?
Oh, well, we stayed put until they took us back down to, off those mountains, back down to the shore, and into a camp that was set up. Yeah, and everybody was so happy and giggly that we're going home. We ain't going to fight no more. Mm-hmm. It's a lot more than doggone Japs. And we were all happy about going back, and we praised that atom bomb for saving our lives. Yeah. You know, that's what it was. Mm-hmm. We saved, not only saved our lives, but it saved the Japs.
Yeah.
Because they would have lost twice as much. Mm-hmm. And it was saved their, you know, the Japanese had their homeland ready to fight. They had the men, women, and children, mm-hmm. plus everybody else in between, ready to fight us, and millions. And they figured that they're going to lose an awful lot of people there, mm-hmm. and a lot of soldiers. It would have been about 1 million soldiers would have been killed. Mm-hmm. That's what they figured. So it saved them, and it saved us.
So how long were you in? So what did you think when they told you were going to Korea?
Well, we figured, well, we didn't believe it, because why would we be going to Korea? We got this thinking, and then start talking about that. We're going to Korea to disarm the Japs. What? We're going to Korea to disarm the Japs? Well, what if the Japs decide to fight us, you know? Mm-hmm. At that time, I read the book, the Jap military mm-hmm. did not want to give up, even after the bomb was hit. Mm-hmm. They did not want to give up. But Hirohito, their emperor, mm-hmm. he told them, he said, you're going to surrender. Mm-hmm. And his word was law. Mm-hmm. So that's what it was. So we went to Korea, and those Koreans, they looked at us with envy. They couldn't figure out who we were. I mean, we Americans, we said we defeated the Japanese. They couldn't believe it, because nobody beats the Japs. Mm-hmm. And so we went in there. We took our positions. We went on the train, and troop train in Korea, and those Japs, they were on another car alongside our tracks, maybe about two tracks away. They were in their cars, and they were looking at us. We were looking at them. Mm-hmm. I think they're looking at us to check, want to see what we look like. Mm-hmm. I mean, because we're all armed, every one of us. And the Japs had to give up their arms. But anyways, what we done, we took all our arms away from them completely. We put them in a warehouse. And we had a company of soldiers around the warehouse. But then we took over the town of Seoul. And what we done, took over the streets, we took over the banks, and we had martial law. And nobody had to be on the streets. They were supposed to be off. And we patrolled the streets in Corriere, and those people are, they were afraid of us. They were looking at us, and they wouldn't come out and talk to us or nothing. But anyways, we had Jeep patrols too, mm-hmm. all up and down the streets in Korea. And the thing is, what happened there then, we were there for a while. The Russians had the northern part. We had the 38th parallel separated South Korea from North Korea. Mm-hmm. Which was a big mistake, because we had the power, we had the strength, we had the two air forces out there now, and a big navy. Mm-hmm. We could have taken North Korea. We wouldn't have had all this problem today. Mm-hmm. We were strong, but no, the politicians up there in Washington had to figure things out with Russia. Mm-hmm. It's a good thing we didn't. They surrendered to us, not to the Russians. So that, in other words, then you wouldn't have like in Germany.
Right.
Where you have the Russians on one side and the Americans on the other. But then what happened there, we finally had to give in to the Russians up in Washington. So the Russians took the northern part of Korea. We took the southern part, the 38th parallel. We had our troops on the 38th parallel, but we had more damn soldiers there than the Russians did. Then the Russians started to fortify the 38th parallel. I said, whoa, we were alerted. Mm. Our units were alerted and everything else. And we started, the other units started going towards the 38th parallel, and they camped along there, ready to fight. And we were alerted, ready to go. And we're just waiting all this time to go to the 38th parallel. Mm-hmm. But nothing happened. For us, so we stayed. It's fine. We liked it just like it was. We didn't want to go up there. But if we had to, we can do it. And so finally, the Russians backed off. Mm. When you face the Russians with superior power, mm-hmm. they kind of chicken out, and they chickened out on that 38th parallel. So they didn't do anything else. They just stayed there. Mm-hmm. No fortifying. No nothing. But then we took, like I said, we took everything away from them. We took our, that's where I got my swords. Mm. I got them from we had them in a warehouse. I took two swords and a bayonet. But somebody stole my machine gun from me, Jap machine gun, fatheads. I had them in my sack, you know, from Korea, from Philippines. Mm-hmm. Then when I got to Korea, our sacks got screwed up, and they stole my machine gun, my Jap machine gun. That would have been a nice trophy then. But, you know, then I was taking pictures off the walls around in Korea there, mm-hmm. On our patrols. And it was Japanese, prints, mm-hmm. drawing and stuff, you know, Japanese drawing. Mm-hmm. Well, I start taking them and put them in my sack, and I say, "Oh, I'll keep these. These are probably worth money." Mm-hmm. So I don't know who the hell saw me do that. They took my pictures. They stole them. I said, "What I was thinking about doing is getting a doggone piece of shit. See if they'll steal that from me and put it in a bag." And I said, "No, I guess I better not."
So, how did you find, when you went home, where did you go?
When I got home?
Well,
I went home.
No.
Oh, 50.
How do I want to put that? Go ahead, Sam.
5220 Club, that's what that was.
The 5220 Club?
Yeah.
52 weeks, 20
yeah,
bucks. Yeah,
5220. 52 weeks at 20 bucks. The government gave us. And we called
when
it. We called it the 5220 Club. Big deal. But they gave us a little present. 5220.
So, what song were they playing on the boats when they took you home?
What was they playing?
Mm-hmm. Sailors were playing Sentimental Journey.
Oh, this was when I was getting on there. They were playing, they were playing Sentimental Journey. I'm gonna take a da doo dee doo doo. I'm gonna take my trip on home. You know, that's what it was. And they played that for us, the Navy did.
Nice.
We were all happy.
Mm-hmm.
We're going home, man. We're safe. No more fighting.
And I know you went straight home, didn't you?
When you got
to the States and to Chicago?
No. No. Me and Kozlowski, I think his name was, and the other guy was a Greek. I forgot his name. So we're going to do the town. Why go home? Hell, these other, you know, while we were fighting the war, all these young other sailors and soldiers were having a good time in Chicago. Hell, they had free rides on streetcars, cabs was giving free rides, and they had parties in downtown Chicago, in the Drake Hotel, way up on the 20th floor, the 25th floor. And hell, me and these other two guys, we're like strangers looking, oh yeah, man, we thought we'd never see this place again, you know? And, you know, we're all Chicago guys. And a guy steps off from the hallway. Hey, let's see what the hell this guy wants. What do I say? You guys looking for a good time? The Drake Hotel on the 11th floor. They got big bands up there, and they got all kinds of drinks, and they got all kinds of stuff going on there. The victory parties and all that kind of stuff. Get up there and get all the gals you want, too. There's a lot of them up there. And the Greek says, let's go. I like that idea. So we went up. We went up there, and man, they had everything, all kinds of drinks, they had all kinds of stuff to eat. I mean, everything. I said, whoa, this is something. This is stuff we've been missing when we're overseas, because these guys who were here were getting all this damn stuff during the war. I mean, Chicago was good for service people. They were good. They got free rides, cab rides, streetcar rides, elevated rides, and they got restaurants would give them free meals. The first meal is free, the second was a discount, and all that kind of stuff, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And here we were overseas, and we heard all about this stuff.
You were eating out of cans.
We were eating out of cans and K-rations and everything else. I was like, damn. So that's why we were happy to get home.
Mm-hmm.
We were happy.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, we first time we start seeing white women. Hey, look at that woman there. Always saw those damn niggers over there in those jungles, you know. Didn't give us any thrill. They were naked. Didn't give us a
even
thrill.
Even naked and you didn't like
Nah, we didn't. They, we, we wanted our own kind.
So how long, what did you do? Did you?
What?
You went to a parties? And
yeah, I went
how
to.
How long did it take you to get home?
Oh, well, we were in Chicago about a week. A week, and we had this motel. Then Kozlowski, he got sick. He wasn't feeling too good. He had malaria. I had malaria too, but not like him. I guess I had it pretty bad, but he couldn't take it, that malaria. From what I heard later on, it killed him. He died from it.
Mm.
And I forgot the Greek's name. We were in touch with each other. Then we lost each other's numbers or something. But I heard that he was doing okay. From somebody else I met. But anyways, I was in Chicago there, and I don't want anybody in my family to know yet. I still have some time to celebrate. So. Well, guess who the hell gives me away? It was Ann Neusel. She was at the Chicago Theater. They had those big, shows and everything else. And what I done is, I saw her. She says, Joe, is that you? Joe Nasty? I said, that's me. Well, when did you get home? And we thought you were gone. I said, I was. I said, we got home about 2 or 3 days ago. Did you go home? I said, no, not yet. I'm on my way. She says, how could you stay home, away from home? I said, well, I was here with some buddies, and they wanted me to stay with them a little bit, you know. And I said, oh, that's nice. Then she calls my house and tells my mother and father I'm home. They wouldn't believe it, because Joey wouldn't do that. He comes straight home. But when I got home, I caught hell from my father, not my mother. My father grabbed a hold of my damn ear like he used to do all the time. I said, Pa, I'm a combat veteran, man. You don't do that to a combat man. It didn't matter to Pa. He was about twice as big as I was.
Or three times when you came home. You probably didn't weigh too much.
I weighed 100. From 190 pounds, I went down to 128 in combat. Mm-hmm. 128. And but Pa had got out the game. He weighed 260 pounds. So he was a little bit bigger than I was.
Just a little.
But anyways.
So who spotted you first?
The cab was looking for the address, because they hadn't moved when I was in service, mm-hmm. when I was overseas. And the cab was looking for the doggone address. I had the address, 2628 McVickers, you know, and I'm looking. I said, well, I asked the cab driver, I said, is this McVickers? He said, I don't know. I guess it is. That's where I turned. I said, well, make sure, because this is where I got to go. And he says, so we're looking at the address. And who I see walking down the sidewalk? My brother, I see a sailor guy, big husky guy. I said, well, a sailor, maybe he lives around. We got closer, and they stopped looking at the cab. They figured it might be me. And I figured that was them. So I told the cab driver, I said, take it real easy here. I said, I think maybe I'm going to have to get off her. So it stopped real easy. I'm looking. Johnny looks my way, and he's trying to figure out who's in the cab. So I know who he was. So I told the cab driver, I says, hey, I'm going to get off here. I says, how much I owe you? He says, forget it. He says, this is on me, buddy. Oh, thanks a lot. So I jumped out of the cab. I went towards my brother, Joey! And he had a big box of pastries. You know, he took those pastries and threw them up in the air to grab me, and I'm looking at them doggone pastries. I'm just drooling for those pastries, and I'm grabbing home. We hugged each other. Uncle Joe came over to me. He hugged me, too. He said, and Uncle Joe started hollering at me. He said, why don't you say your tongue? Blah, 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 blah. You know how Uncle Joe is.
Yeah.
And my brother John says, when'd you get in? I told him, so Uncle Joe wouldn't hear me. I said, a week ago. We picked them, my pastries up. They were kind of mashed, but they're still in the box. They're rumbled up and everything. So took them in the house. When I got in that house, Pa started hollering at me, because he finally found out that I was in Chicago a week. And my mother's crying, and everybody else is crying, and all that stuff. So that's how it ended. And then I'm walking at night throughout the house. Everybody's asleep, and I couldn't believe I was home. I'm looking around. I go down the stairs into the first floor and look around. I climb back up again. And, you know, the whole 9 yards out. I couldn't believe I was home, because I didn't think I ever was going to get back, you know.
You used a lot of guardian angels.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. That's why I heard him say one time, he says, hey, boss, when are you going to relieve me? This guy's killing me. Well, anyways, that's how it was. And I had the 5220 club for a while.
Explain the 5220.
5220. The government was nice to us. They was going to give us $20 a month for 52 weeks. How many weeks in a year?
52 weeks.
52, yeah.
1 year.
So all the GIs, soldiers, were calling it the 5220 Club. 5220. Big deal. But anyways, it was some money anyway. It was 20 bucks. Yeah. But the thing is, when you signed up for it, you sign up early for it, so you get some money in your pocket. But I took about, I took almost a good, almost a year off. Just couldn't believe I was home. I took a year off and to fool around, going here and going there, and I was over at Johnny Boy's house, and he come to see me, you know, and all that. We see each other, and that's when we decided to get in our car and come down to Florida. And he went home, and I stayed, and I've been there ever since. And I stayed.
1948, right?
Huh?
You've been here since 1948.
Yeah.
Wow. Did you meet Grandma here? Grandma Nasty?
Did I meet her here?
No, was she here before you? Or?
No, I was.
You first?
I was first.
Oh, wow.
You know, because I didn't want any more winter. Mm-hmm. I come out of those damn hot jungles into Chicago. I says, no way. I couldn't take it, man. I'll tell you, after being in 3 years in a dang gone heat in the jungles, I wasn't going to stay in that cold weather. As I'm heading for Florida, got relatives down here, so I go and stay with them. That's what I did. I stayed with that Martha and all this Marcos. Mm-hmm. But we had a good time with the family and all. Mm-hmm. And I remember one time we, after this big battle that we had, we stopped for a while to regroup, and we stayed there about a week after this big battle. But we had all kinds of Japs laying out there, and you know, in that hot weather, they begin to ripen. And they were blowed up like a balloon, with they're all wet from their bodies, and I couldn't take that smell, because we had to stay there, dig in for our next event, and it stunk to high hell. I couldn't take it. I put a handkerchief up my nose, and those maggots were all over those dang old bodies, coming out of their nose and out of their eyes. They were all over. And you can hear them eating all night long, crackling. And I couldn't take that damn smell. And I cover up this way, and I put my hands up, you know. And you couldn't move. You had to stay there. Because that we dug in there. There was a line, fortification. And we had to take that damn smell along with the battle. But anyways, we didn't stay there too long, because I think after about a couple of days, we picked up and went somewhere else. And I told you about the rockets, didn't I? Mm. That we went after? We heard, you know, we were one of those battles. We heard that the noise from way off, like screaming ninnies. Mm-hmm. You know, it went, wee, wee, whoop, wee. That's what all that noise is. We heard it for a few nights, way off in the distance. So we got word we're going to go out in that direction. Mm-hmm. So we started moving towards there, and they brought in a bunch of trucks. And for once, we wasn't going to walk. We got on the trucks, and it took us within a certain distance, and then we got off the trucks, and we had to walk the rest of the way. And man, we looked out at night especially. It was weird. Mm. They light up the sky in trails of fire. Mm. You know, they go, I mean, like fingers, you know, going into the sky, like looking for us. Mm-hmm. And we come to find out that we're supposed to go out there and take them out. Mm. And so I said, oh crap, now what? And the guys were all worried. We never come across anything like that. Mm. And what we've done is we kept on going in that direction. and there was a wide open field between us and the foothills of those mountains. Well, we had to cross that wide open space. So we figured, well, that's pretty dangerous there, you know. So what they've done, they brought in the planes, and they smoke planes. They smoke that whole area so we can walk through it and not see us. Well, we did that, but we got to the foothills. Good thing. We made it through that wide open space. Now the fun begins. We had to go into those foothills and head them towards, get to the rockets. And we got to so far, that night, they started firing those rockets. But they wasn't firing at us, they were firing somewhere else. I says, thank God. It was kind of weird. It sounded spooky,
yeah.
Real spooky. I said, you know, it kind of was getting on our nerves. So we kept on going the next day, and what happened is we got close, and the Japs was going to have a little fun with us. So what they started to do was shoot them rockets. And they were firing those rockets, but they wasn't doing anything. But then they turned those rockets around, and they were coming at us then. Mm-hmm. But they were using what they call a rolling barrage. Mm-hmm. You know what that is? Mm-hmm. The barrage going like this, rolling barrage. Mm-hmm. Well, we were dug in because we were supposed to go in to take them out. Mm-hmm. But it was kind of rattling our nerves. So what they'd done, they sent up a Piper Cub plane. And that little tiny engine went, it's funny as hell because everything was strong and hard and big motors. There comes that little dinky plane. It must be that thing, the small thing flying around. But anyways, that plane was spotting those daggone rockets. Mm-hmm. Was sending word back to artillery. And artillery then started to try to find them. And they started blowing up some things. I think they were, but they didn't. Those things are coming back strong as hell. Mm-hmm. So what happened, they zeroed those rockets in on us. Mm-hmm. They know we were in there. We're all dug in. And we're supposed to go after them. And what happened, they started a barrage. A rolling barrage, walking barrage. And I mean, I was scared. I never was that scared before in my life, because I know I was shaking, but I never knew people would shake when they're scared. Mm-hmm. But I found something new about me. I was going with Dan, you know, and Berkshire, he was our sergeant. He was there with us. He jumped out of that doggone pillbox and he started running. Well, we went after him, dragged his ass back down into that pit, got him down in there. And there was that doggone barrage just coming at us. And we had, what was his name now? One of the Sanchez, one of the guys. He's a real nice guy, but he got hit by the flying shrapnel. Mm-hmm. And you know, when them things hit, when they hit the ground, they don't fly up this way like a flower. Mm-hmm. What they do, they cut the grass. When it hits down, it goes horizontal, mm-hmm, that way. So you better find a doggone depression on the ground if you want to live. Mm-hmm. But that doggone thing hit Sanchez in the back and split him open like a pig. Mm-hmm. From the shoulder on down to his butt, he's wide open, that thing. Of course, he died. He didn't live long. But that barrage, the next barrage, the next, you know, it came up real close to us. Uh-huh. The next barrage is supposed to hit us. I mean, we figured it's going to hit us. And I know we all said our prayers. But that next barrage came in and went over us. Over it. We were here and it went over us. Uh-huh. And thank God it didn't hit any of us guys. And we were dug in. But But the next day, we got the word, go. Mm-hmm. We're going to have to get those rockets because it was shaking up everybody. So we went, we started moving in there, and we hit infantry. The infantry was over protecting their canisters. And we come in, and then, well, we had almost hand-to-hand fighting. They come at us by droves, try to keep us away from those rockets. And we come in, I mean, just bunches of us. We went in there, and they told us we got to get them doggone rockets because it's the Corps wants us to get them out, because it's screwing up everybody's mind. And so we finally got in there, and the thing is, the Japs were, some Japs, they disappeared, and they had just what they call a rear guard. Mm-hmm. Well, we dispatched the rear guard, and we got the canisters. And what happened then? The guys that analyze these things, what the hell I call them? Anyways, they says, don't destroy them. We want them. Mm-hmm. We want to study them. What those kind of, those, uh-huh. Yeah. You know.
The specialists.
Yeah. I forget what the hell they call them. Anyways, they wanted those cannons. I wish she hears that. Was she sleeping? Was she sleeping?
No, she was watching TV.
Watching TV. Well, anyways, intelligence was the one I was thinking of.
Okay.
Intelligence wanted information on those things. Mm-hmm. They didn't want us to blow them up. They want to save them. Okay, so we saved them, and they were down there checking them out and everything. And but anyway, we took that that bunch, and everybody was relieved, because they were making everybody nervous, those things. Especially at night, you hear them screaming and you see trailing fires and sparks behind them as it's going through the air, you know. But then the next day, we seen that sailors. Did I tell you about them?
Were the ones that came?
They came looking for the front lines. Yay! Where's the front lines? We were already dug in and everything else. They said, "You're in for you. This is it. You're in the front lines." What? Yeah. That Jeep made a U-turn and got the hell out of there and went back.
So, Dad, I don't have any more questions.
Oh,
I
don't? Mm-hmm. Well, maybe.
Do you have anything else you'd like to talk about?
Well, we can talk about the celebrations we had amongst ourselves.
I would love to hear about
your
celebrations.
Well, we play I forgot this guy from Texas. I forgot his name. He had his banjo with him or something, and it's a small one he carried with him. And he played that thing. We're all sitting around in the jungle, happy as hell. And he played that thing, and we'd all sing, and all kinds of stuff going on. And then Amos, he could play that thing too, and he grabbed it and he started playing. And this guy from Texas, he's doing a Hawaiian dance with that thing. He's shaking his ass and everything. And we're laughing like crazy. One guy told me, said, "Man, you keep on doing that. So you're looking more like a woman, but you got to watch yourself." He's, you touch me, I'll kill you.
What'd you do for Christmas celebration?
Oh, we were, Christmas, we were, nothing really, we was up in the foxholes. Mm. But things were kind of quiet on Christmas Eve. I mean, nothing's going on. We were in our foxholes, and we were waiting and waiting, but the Japs didn't attack us or nothing, because they usually like to attack you on your holidays. And we were just sitting there waiting for that. And then the next day they gave us some turkey to eat and stuff. You know, we had.
You got a hot meal?
Yeah.
Your first hot meal in 306 days?
Yeah. Well, you know, talk about hot meals. When the chuck wagon came up, that's a truck, they had kitchen stuff in there, and they, once in a while, they treat us to hot meals. Mm-hmm. So we were all dug in, and we're supposed to get a hot meal that day. So three guys at a time, or two at a time, went back to we call it a chuck wagon, but it's a truck over there with hot food and everything else. And so it was me and Clay. He looked like a gorilla. Clay, he's a husky guy. He was our BAR man. A BAR is a heavy dang on automatic rifle to carry. Mm. And him being big and everything else, it was nothing to him. Mm. So me and him together went back to get our meal. We walking around, you know, nonchalantly. All of a sudden he grabs a hold of me. He stopped me. I said, what? I got the message. You know what he's telling me? There's two Japs down there laying on the ground. They're alive and they're breathing. You know, that's when I was okay. He says, he got his automatic rifle. And he says, you and me, you know, just, I said, okay. So we're going to, those two of them, what they was relying on is, we're supposed to be thinking that they're dead. Mm-hmm. And they're going to shoot us, kill us as we pass them, you know, going to ambush us. Mm-hmm. So we said, well, let's find out. So we got it at different positions. I went this way, he went that way. And one body's there, the other body's over there. So he took the body on the right, I took the one on the left. And they're both breathing, boy. So what he done, he fired first. As he fired first, that other just started to move, and I fired on him. Mm-hmm. I put about three shots in him. And we killed him right there, and we got on top, we kicked them up over on the side, see if they're still breathing. Mm-hmm. And they wasn't. They were there. They knew we'd be walking back right to get something to eat. They're going to ambush us. Mm-hmm. But the good thing Clay found out. He warned me. He says, mm-hmm. He pointed to. I got the message. But it's a good thing he had a sharp eye. He's from Ohio. Mm-hmm. But he looked like the Razorback gorilla. That's how big he was. He could have just thrown his rifle away and just grabbed him.
What's the longest you went without a hot meal?
Yeah.
What's the longest?
Oh, what's the longest? Mm-hmm. Oh, over a month. Mm-hmm. Over a month and a half.
So you ate out of cans for a month.
Yeah, we even had the preacher come up there, come up to the front, and what he'd done, he had his buddy, his assistant, drive a Jeep up there. Well, he got as close as he could. He didn't get way up there, but as close as he could. And what we'd done, we sent a patrol out, make sure that there's no Japs around, to protect the preacher. So what he done, he says, I want the Catholics first. You know, he's going to give us a communion and everything. Mm-hmm. So we went up there to him, and it was about three or four of us. And he laid a white cloth on the hood of the Jeep, and he put his stuff out there, his hosts and everything. And he gave us communion, mm-hmm. and whatever's supposed to happen, he did. And we went back. He says, send me three more. I said, okay, what do you want, Protestant or Catholic? He says, send me three Protestants. Okay, so we went back. He said, they want three Protestants, sir. I said, okay. And he called out three guys. They went up there. And I told him about the, he knew about those Japs that we killed. Mm. And what he'd done then, the captain, he dispatched about five or six, half a squad, mm-hmm. to protect us. The guys going back and forth to the Jeep, to the church. Mm-hmm. And he had them out there, you know, just in case. But anyways, the guys that wanted to go to church, they had a church right mm-hmm. there. And then, about a week later, he comes back. This is another guy now. This is a dentist. He come out. And he had one of them bicycle things, you know, that kind of. Well, it was in his truck, on his Jeep. Uh-huh. Pulled it out, set it down, and he checked our teeth. But in there, he had a drill. The drill was, but he had a guy sitting on a bicycle, and he turned that daggone thing out, and he used the drill. Well, you know, that's a rough one.
Oh, yeah.
He put that on your teeth, you know. So he got me up in there. I said, you don't see any cavities, do you, Doc? He says, let me know. Just take it easy. I'll let you know. And he's looking at my mouth and down inside. And I'm looking to see if there's any Japs around. I was only taking a chance. Me shooting, get shot by a doggone Jap with my mouth open. But anyways... He said, no, you're okay. I said, thank God. I don't want to get with that damn thing on my tooth. These other guys are complaining, bitching like crazy. Because he says, man, I said, did you ever have that dang-on thing on your tooth? He says, it's like a hand drill. You know, you pump. <He's> I was glad I didn't get mine. Yeah. He didn't get to see it.